Thank you very much, Mr. President. Mr. President, late yesterday afternoon, when we have a break in the session, I was handed a copy of a motion seeking my inhibition. And I read it very carefully, Mr. President, and I wanted to stand up even then to reply point by point to the false allegations contained in that motion. But unfortunately, we didn't go through with the session because the defense was unprepared. But now, Mr. President, at the first occasion, I woke up this morning seeing the motion almost bannered by every newspaper and listened to the radio also bannering the story. It eclipsed, Mr. President, the family thrill at seeing my grandson, Edgardo Angara, 7-year-old, winning a tennis tournament at the Rizal Coliseum. So I would like you to read the Philippine Star Sports, Angara pulled through in first-gen opener. Well, Mr. President, I'm not an athlete, but to me, this is a source of thrill because my grandson, the son of Congressman Sonny Angara, is only 7-year-old, and yet he joined a 10-year and under competition. So that's for the athletic skill of the Angaras. Mr. President, when we were convened as an impeachment court, we didn't expect, we didn't seek this role. It was mandated by the Constitution that we shall sit as senator judges. And therefore, it's a constitutional task assigned to us, Mr. President, and I consider it as a constitutional duty on my part to act as a judge, and no argument, no persuasion can convince me that I should inhibit because this is a duty I will not abdicate. Mr. President, I did not have a hand in choosing Sonny Angara, my son, to be a spokesperson for the House of Representatives. The two houses are quite separate and distinct, co-equal. We honor their own respective processes. So I have no hand at all in telling anyone, please choose Sonny Angara to be one of the spokesperson. But the worst thing about this motion, Mr. President, is the insinuation that, or the suspicion that I will be unbiased and unprejudiced because of that relationship. And this, Mr. President, the malicious insinuation that political favors have been extended to my province of Aurora, in effect, insinuating that my vote has already been bought as a result, Mr. President. They mentioned, Mr. President, three major projects that was just recently approved by the NEDA. And of the three, Mr. President, only one really concerns and was for Aurora, and that is the Baler-Casiguran concreting project. Mr. President, that project is not going to be funded by Philippine money, not by the savings and taxes of Filipinos. It will be funded wholly by the Korean government, Mr. President. I got that, Mr. President, 3 years ago during the past administration, not under this administration. The only thing that happened during this administration is that it was approved by NEDA, which is required for all foreign-funded projects. The other two, Mr. President, is a project, I think, of a circumferential road in Samar. I'm very thankful, and I'm full of admiration for those who were able to secure that, because Samar is such an undeveloped province, and putting a circumferential road like in Bohol would really make Samar a destination of investments and tourism. The third project, Mr. President, is the bridge over Umirai River. Umirai River, Mr. President, for those who don't know it, is the river in Aurora base, located in Dingalan, which supplies all the water for Metro Manila to Angat Dam. And that project, I hope I was the one who initiated, but I did not, Mr. President. It was a project of Governor Suarez and Congressman Suarez, funded again by the Japanese government, not by our own, government. And yet, Mr. President, the petitioners have the gall and the audacity to suggest that these are political favors for me. So I reject that, Mr. President, and I reject it as an unthinking and illogical conclusion that serves no purpose at all except to malign and make, I don't want to say it, it may be a diversionary tactic on their part, because you just scolded them, Mr. President, yesterday for their unpreparedness. But I won't say that. Mr. President, they also cited the application of the judicial the judicial rule, the code of judicial conduct. Mr. President, even a first-year law student who knows how to read will immediately conclude that the code of judicial conduct is not applicable to the Senate, much less to the impeachment court. We have our own set of rules, and the only code or rules we adopted as supplementary are the rules of court, Mr. President. So that is completely irrelevant and immaterial, Mr. President. There they say, my son is a party litigant. You see, even a first-year student will know that a party litigant is one who will suffer or benefit from a decision made. My son will not benefit from any decision either way. The only one who will benefit or suffer is our Chief Justice. And here are his lawyers who seem to devise a strategy of almost antagonizing half of this court, Mr. President. First, they want Senator Drilon to be inhibited. Then Senator Gingona, they're pointing to Senator Pangilinan and Recto, because they simply happen to be party mates of the President. Mr. President, many of us are party members. We are affiliated in one way or the other with one party or another. And all of us, except possibly one or two parties, are all supportive of government reform, of government program. Does that mean that the entire impeachment court is biased and partial? There is no other interpretation I can read into these actuations of the defense, Mr. President, except to destroy the credibility of this impeachment court. I think that's the least that they ought to do, because this could be the saving grace in our democracy. If you destroy the one pillar of justice, the Senate, who can stand up even to the Supreme Court or the President, then you are really knocking down the very pillar that one day you may have to seek help and succor from, because it can stand up to any person or institution. And to see how malicious this insinuation is, Mr. President, in their concluding paragraph, they said, the only way Senator Angara can redeem himself is to vote for acquittal. Mr. President, you know, I've been president of the UP, I've been president of the Integrated Bar, I've been president of the ASEAN Law Association, I've been honored by all of these organizations in various ways. I've never seen logic or legal logic like this. And therefore, Mr. President, I take umbrage at this malicious paper, my good friend Joker, when I showed him the petition yesterday, he said, "Ed, don't answer it. It's not worth it because you are doing a constitutional duty." They don't seem to appreciate that. And yet Joker is very sympathetic, and I can share his feelings towards the cause of the defense. So you see, as of now, but after this, maybe not anymore. So, Mr. President, I don't know. I have one outstanding alumnus of the UP College of Law, very able, very skillful, very eloquent, and can stand up in argument head to head with anyone. But he has one outstanding trait. He has a penchant for antagonizing the judge. So no client will now retain him, because what's the use? He may have a good cause, but if you antagonize the judge, your cause is lost. No, I'm not comparing our set of defense, our panel of defense, to that one friend of mine who's brilliant, knowledgeable, eloquent, but has a penchant for antagonizing the judge. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Thank you, Senator Angara. The chair would like to state for the record that we respect the opinion of others regarding each one of us or all of us collectively. But I assure you that none of you can sway us one way or the other. And if you have any reason to believe that we are dishonest, say so candidly and openly. And we are ready, willing, able to defend ourselves. So let us forget about this sad incident. Let's proceed with the case. Defense, present your evidence.